Hi friends. So hope you all have watched my first video for the sixth module. Now, in this second lecture video, we will be discussing about the next major topic of our module 6, that is multi degrees of freedom system. See, module 6 or as an hour comprises of three major sections. One was whirling speed or critical speed that we have already discussed. Now the second topic will be multi degrees of freedom systems. And finally, one more topic is the torsional vibrations. See, all the three sections, that means whirling of shafts, multi degrees of freedom system, and torsional vibrations, all the three systems are the major topics related to which you will be facing numerical problems plus derivations. Now remaining section of this module comprises of small theory sections, that is vibration measurements, vibration absorption, and vibration isolation. Okay, so now let us discuss the second major topic that is related to both derivations as well as the numerical examples that will be asked for the university question. This is multi degrees of freedom system. Now already in our fifth module we have covered degrees of freedom, single degrees of freedom system, 2 degrees of freedom system, 3 degrees of freedom system. What are the difference between all those things? We have covered the basics of degrees of freedom systems. So you all know what might be multi degrees of freedom system. See, from 2 degrees of freedom system, everything or every system that comprises of more than one parameter to describe the system as a whole can be considered as multi degrees of freedom system. Now as a start for this one, let us try to mathematically represent a multi degrees of freedom system. Please look at the mathematical model that I have drawn here. The total system comprises of 2 masses and 3 springs. Now the 2 masses are given denominations M1 and M2. 3 springs are attached here. The stiffness of those springs are given as K1, K2 and K. Now in this arrangement, mass 1 always tends to move as well as mass 2 always tends to move. Let X1 be the displacement covered by mass 1 and X2 be the displacement covered by mass 2. Now X1 and X2 will be totally different value. Those displacements or deflections will be dependent upon so many external factors with respect to this mathematical model. So this system can be considered as a typical 2 degrees of freedom system, because to completely understand or explain the system, satisfy the system, we have to know 2 different parameters, that is X1 and X2. It is not dependent on, the completion of the system is not dependent on a single parameter. Hence, this comes under a 2 degrees of freedom system, which is nothing but a multi degrees of freedom system. Degrees of freedom other than 1 can be considered inside this topic, multi degrees of freedom system. So, in this topic, what we have to study is, we have to learn how to represent a multi degrees of freedom system, both in the free vibration condition as well as forced vibration condition. See, this is a free vibration condition because no external excitation or forces are acting on the system. Now the same scenario you have to develop in a forced vibration condition also. Now along with free and forced, now this is an undamped system. No damper is connected to this vibrating model. That means no vibration arresting is occurring here. So this is an example for free undamped multi degrees of freedom system. Similarly, what you have to learn, you have to also learn about forced damped multi degrees of freedom system also. What we are about to learn now, the derivation with respect to this system is very, very important. because derivation as a whole can be asked for the university examination, as well as the numerical examples also can be asked. Now the numerical example totally depends upon the method of deriving the governing equations for the system. While deriving the governing equations, we'll arrive at solutions as well as the natural frequency of vibration of the system also. Let us get into deriving the governing equations of the system. Now we'll be using equilibrium method. That means let the total forces acting on the system be equal to zero. Now how will we write the forces accordingly compatible to the system? Let us start one by one. Let us take the example of mass m1. With respect to mass m1, what you have to look is, you have to individually focus on a single component within this system. While you are going to write the forces related to mass m1, only concentrate on mass m1 and the immediate connected members with respect to m1. So mass is the component which induces inertia force. So definitely, what is inertia force? Mass into acceleration. Here displacement is x1 related to mass. So this second derivative of the displacement we will obtain as acceleration. So first force we can write as m1 x1 double dot. This is inertia force. Next k1, this spring constant k1, that means this spring is connected to mass m1. So spring is the element which induces spring force or restoring force. That can be written as what? Plus k1 into x1. This is dependent on the deflection x1. Now one more component of force will be acting on the system because m1 is connected to the external spring k also. Now k is, if you look carefully on k, k is connected both to m1 as well as m2. That means the deflection with respect to k depends on both x1 and x2. And as we are writing the forces related to mass m1 here, the displacement with respect to mass m1 is x1. So the third term we should write as k into x1 minus x2. In this form, we don't know which is greater. We don't know if x1 is greater or x2 is greater. So while we are talking about mass m1, which is the direct relation with x1, so while we are writing equation with respect to that one, we will be taking x1 minus x2 multiplied with k, third spring. As there is no external excitation acting on this system, we can write this equal to zero because no external force is being acting here. This is the equation written for what? M1. Now similarly, if we write equation for m2, what will we obtain? Concentrate on only m2. See, m2 and the connected members, k2 is connected to m2 as well as k. So let us start by writing the inertia force, m2 into x2 double dot, m into a, acceleration, second derivative of x, second, k2 into x2, the restoring force related to k2 depends only on the deflection x2, and the third one, k. Now k is connected to m1 as well as m2. Now as we are writing the equation related to m2, the direct deflection for m2 is x2, hence we will be writing k multiplied by x2 minus x1 in this manner in the second equation. I hope this equation is clear to you. Correct? Now you can pause the video, you can note this one down, you can note down the diagram and write down this equation because I am going to rub down this figure. Now let us slightly convert this equation. That means let us correlate the terms within this equation. Now this can be rewritten as m1 x1 double dot plus, now let us bring to the terms with respect to x1 here, k1 plus k x1, last remaining one is minus k x2 equal to 0. Let it be equation number 1. Similarly for mass m2, let us rearrange this equation also, m2 x2 double dot plus, now here we have terms related to, common terms related to x2, and those terms are k2 plus k x2 minus k x1 equal to 0. Let it be equation number 2. See, carefully do by yourselves by rearranging the
terms. Now let us run the initial equation. Okay, so what we have here is two equations related to two masses which was connected within the system. First one is the inertia force with respect to the two similar components with respect to x1, we have correlated in a single term, and then h2 equal to 1. Now we have two equations. Now x is the displacement happening here, so let us assume a certain value related to x. As we have taken in the previous module, fifth module, let us assume x1 to be equal to a1 sine omega t plus 5, and let x2 be equal to a2 sine omega t plus 5. Now if you take phi or if you ignore phi, both won't make any difference. Now phi here represents only the phase difference. The sine value, the sine component here represents, it is a sinusoidal function or a harmonic function. So what is x1 and x2 here? They both are displacements. Okay, so if x1 is a1 sine omega t plus 5, you have x1 here, x1 terms you have in both equations, also you have x1 double dot term. So let us differentiate it with respect to time. The second derivative you can directly write as, if you differentiate it two times, what will you obtain? Minus a1 omega square sine omega t plus 5. Similarly, if you differentiate x2 two times with respect to t, time, you will obtain minus a2 omega square sine omega t plus 5. Both these terms are important for us. Okay, look at carefully these terms, pause the video, write down these terms, yourselves try to differentiate the terms. Now let us substitute these values onto equation 1 as well as equation 2. Now while substituting, just look into this one carefully. See, you have m1 into x1 double dot. So in place of x1 double dot, you will write this term. This term as sine omega t plus 5. Similarly here, you have x1. What is x1? a1 sine omega t. Again you have sine omega t plus 5. Next, k into x2. What is x2? x2 is this one. In this term also, sine omega t plus 5 is there. So all the sine omega t plus 5 terms will be getting cancelled in both equation number 1 as well as 2. Just directly substitute this one. All the sine omega t plus 5, those terms will be getting cancelled as right hand side is equal to 0. Those terms will be getting, you can take it as common and get it cancelled. So now let us substitute these values in equations 1 and 2, ignoring the sine omega t plus 5 term. So equation number 1, how will equation number 1 turn out? m1 multiplied by remaining term will be what? x1 double dot. So here remaining term will be minus a1 omega square. So minus m1 a1 omega square plus here k1 plus k2. And what is here? x1. What is x1 here? Now sine omega t plus 5 will get cancelled. So remaining is a1 alone minus k into what is x2. x2 is this one. Ignoring sine omega t plus 5, you will get a2 equal to 0. The second equation will turn out as, see, m2 into x2 double dot. x2 double dot is this one. We can ignore sine omega t plus 5. So remaining will be minus m2 a2 omega square plus k2 plus k x2. What is x2? This term. Ignore sine omega t plus 5. a2 minus k into x1. K into what is x1? See this one. Ignoring this term, you will have a1 remaining here. So this is the rearranged equation by substituting all these values. Pause the video, note down all these equations. Now within this equation, we can also make a few more rearrangements. Let us rewrite this equation as minus m1 a1 omega square plus, now you have a1 terms common here. You have a1 common here. So keeping the a1 terms in combination, let us write minus m1 omega square plus k1 plus k2 multiplied by a1. Okay,
remaining will be minus k into a2 equal to 0. That is the equation 3. Now, second equation we can write it as, again we can take a2 as the common term here. Minus m2 omega square plus k2 plus k a2 minus k a1 equal to 0. That is the equation number 4. Now, let us make one more substitution here. I mean, the substitution that we are going to do now is only for simplifying this complex equation. That is, let us assume, let k1 equal to k2 equal to a single value k, and m1 equal to m2 equal to a single value m. Let us simply assume these terms. Why are we assuming these terms? Only to simplify this complex equation. So now, how will the third equation be rewritten? We can rewrite and slightly rearrange the equation. That means I will be starting with a1 term, then ending with a2 term for both 3 and 4. First initially a1 term, second a2 term. Okay. So if you substitute these values here, what will you obtain? K1 and k2, it becomes k. So there will be 2k minus m1 omega square multiplied by a1. Remaining will be simply k a2 itself equal to 0. Again, if you substitute the values in equation number 4, you will get k2 plus k, totally k. So that will be again, sorry, this is a1 term and a2 term. So similarly, we will be writing the same in this order also. So let it be minus k a1 plus, let the second term be related to a2. So second term will be what? Again, 2k minus m2 omega square, sorry, m2 omega square into a2 equal to 0. Now, we can cancel this m1 and m2 also and just put the term m here, because that also we have substituted here. So this is the two new equations, equation number 5 and equation number 6. Both equation 5 and 6 are in terms of a1 and a2. Now, where did we get a1 and a2? A1 and a2 came from the initial equation, as x1 is taken as a1 sine omega t plus phi. We have already written that one previously. Also, x2 was equal to, we have substituted that, a2 sine omega t plus phi. Now, a1 and a2 denote the amplitude of displacements. X1 and x2 were the initial displacement for mass m1 and m2. So, with respect to that displacement, a1 and a2 here represents the amplitude of their displacements. Okay, so that is the term a1, a2 in both equations 5 and 6. Now, let us turn these two equations in matrix form. How will we write or convert this one into matrix form? This is also we are doing for simplicity, for solving this equation. Now, while writing in matrix form, this will come in this form. Okay, look carefully. 2k minus m omega square, first term, minus k, the second term, and the second row, this will be minus k, 2k minus m omega square, first matrix, multiplied by our second matrix, compliance of amplitudes should be equal to 0. This is the matrix format. So, see, if you expand this matrix, you will obtain the same equations. First term multiplied with a1 minus second term, sorry, plus second term multiplied with a2. You will get the first equation. Second one, first term multiplied by this one, plus second term multiplied by this one, you will obtain the same equation. Now, the right hand side of this matrix equation contains 0. That means if you take this term to here, that will get cancelled. So, for solving this one, let us take the determinant of this matrix. How will you take the determinant? You have to cross multiply. So, this becomes, if you cross multiply this one, you will get 2k minus m omega square whole square. Cross multiply minus cross multiplication. Minus of this term, this will be k square, should be equal to 0. Now, let us expand this one. This is a minus b whole square. So, this should be 4k square minus a square minus 2ab. That means 4k m omega square plus the last term m omega square the whole square minus k square should be equal to 0. Now k square, this should be 3k square minus 4k m omega square plus m square omega raised to 4. m square omega raised to 4 equal to 0. Now I am going to divide the whole equation using m square. If you divide the whole equation using m square and rearrange this one, and let us start by writing the term omega 4, the term will get cancelled. Minus, now if you divide 4k m omega square divided by m omega square, 1 m will get cancelled, remaining will be divided by m plus 3k square by m equal to 0. Now this equation is very, very important. This equation can be considered as the governing equation for the multi degrees of freedom system that we have already written. Now this is a quadratic equation in terms of what? Omega square. See, omega raised to 4 can be written as what? Omega square the whole square. So this equation will become omega square the whole square minus 4k by m omega square plus 3k square by m. So this is an equation that is represented as a quadratic equation based on the term omega square, not omega, omega square. So how will we solve a quadratic equation, a normal quadratic equation? We have the general solution as, see, if you have a quadratic equation like ax square plus bx plus c equal to 0, what will be the solution? X should be equal to what? Minus b plus or minus square root of b square minus 4ac divided by 2a. The same scenario can be applied to this equation. That means here in place of x you have omega square. So the solution will be omega square equal to, now minus b, what is b? Already minus is there, it will become plus. Now b is 4k by m, so 4k by m plus or minus plus or minus, yeah, the equation radical square root of b square minus 4ac. Now b square is 4k by m, so its square will be 16k square by m square minus 4ac. 4 into a is 1, c is this one, 4 3 is 12 k square by m square. So sorry, this term should be m square. We were dividing throughout the previous equation, we were dividing throughout using m square, so here an m square should be there. Divided by 2 into a. A is 1 here. So this is 2. Simply 2. See, an m square is here, not m. It should be m square. Now, when we simplify this one, 4k by m plus or minus. Now, what will you get inside this square root? 16k square m square minus 12k square m square. This will become 4k square m square. Right? Inside the radical. Now if you bring this one out of the radical, this will turn to be what? 2k by m, right? So we can write this equation as 4k by m plus or minus 2k by m divided by 2. Now divide this one by 2, what will we obtain? This will be equal to 2k by m plus or minus k by m. This is the value for omega square, 2k by m plus or minus k by m. We have a term plus or minus, that means as this is a quadratic equation, there should be definitely two sets of solutions. So let us write both the solutions separately. That means first one we will obtain as omega 1 square. So in the plus or minus sign, let us add both the terms. So this will be equal to 2k by m plus k by m. This will be 3k by m. The second solution will be omega 2 square. This will be, let us subtract the terms, 2k by m minus k by m. So this will be k by m. So as omega 1 square is 3k by m, omega 1 should be equal to root of 3k by m radians per second. Now this should be equal to, omega 2 should be equal to root of k by m radians per second. Both the terms represents the natural frequency of vibration of our multi degrees of freedom system. We have two solutions, that means omega 1 is the natural frequency of the first mode of vibration, while omega 2 is the natural frequency of the second mode of vibration. Always remember this is first mode, and always remember this was the second mode. Now
you remember the fifth equation that we have previously written. Now from the fifth equation, if you take the ratio of a1 by a2, see right hand side you have 0. So directly if you write a1 by a2, the equation will be like this. And from the sixth equation, if you again take the ratio a1 by a2, this will be 2k minus m omega square by k. Please refer equation number 5 and 6 once more and take these ratios yourselves, you will understand. Now in this one, let us substitute the first natural frequency of first mode of vibration. Let's substitute this value. Now what will be this value here? Omega 1 is this one. So if you substitute omega 1 value here, omega is here, this is omega square. So this will be 3k by m. mm get cancelled, you will get 3k here. 2k minus 3k, that will be what? 2k minus 3k, you will get a negative k. So total the value will be what? Minus 1. How we obtained minus 1 here? We are substituting the value of omega 1. We have substituted the value of omega 1 here and expanded, you will get the value, numerical value, negative 1. Now for equation number 6. Now for this ratio, let us substitute the natural frequency of the second mode of vibration. That means let us substitute the value of omega 2 here. Let us substitute the value of omega 2 here. Now what is omega 2? Root of k by m. So omega square should be k by m. So k by m, mm get cancelled, you will have k here, 2k minus k, k, k by k, you will have a positive 1 value. Now what does this represent? For the first mode of vibration, if you take the ratio of amplitudes, you get negative 1. That means both amplitudes are equal to same value, same magnitude, but they are out of phase. This negative value indicates that one. That means A1 and A2, what was A1 and A2? Two amplitudes of vibration. So for the first mode of vibration, both amplitudes of vibration have the same magnitude, same value, but they are out of phase. That is the negative sign indicating here. Now for the second one, you have the positive value 1. Here also, you have the ratio A1 by A2. Now what does this value mean? What does this statement mean? That means for the second mode of vibration, because we have substituted the second natural frequency here, for the second mode of vibration, you have both A1 and A2 having same magnitudes of amplitude, same amplitude, I mean same value of amplitude, as well as they are in phase together. That means for the first mode of vibration, they were out of phase because you had a negative value. For the second mode of vibration, they are in phase. So this negative indicates amplitudes are out of phase, and this positive one indicates amplitudes are in phase. Now both the cases we have what? The magnitude of amplitudes are same. So dear students, please go through the derivation very carefully, because there is a top proximity chance for the derivation being asked in the university question. If the derivation is not asked, definitely you will receive a numerical problem with respect to multi degrees of freedom system. What we have discussed in this video is free undamped multi degrees of freedom system. What we have discussed here was free undamped multi degrees of freedom system, because we don't have any external excitation here, as well as no damper is connected to this system. So definitely you can expect numerical examples coming in the university examination. So if a numerical example comes, the method of solving the numerical problem is also same way as what we have derived. So definitely it is very important to study this derivation as such. These steps you should always remember, don't by heart, just simply understand and write, because while solving the numerical example also, same steps has to be covered. Thank you.